Waldrop, National Education Coordinator for Jatai International. Today, we're going to be working on curly hair. And believe it or not, we are going to use a razor on it. Most people wouldn't touch a razor to curly hair, primarily because of its texture. Most clients would say please don't use it because it expands the hair as opposed to helping it to lay flat and have more fluidity and trendling. We want to see more of a beachy wave, soft flowing trendle of wave and curl. Probably take off about an inch and a half of her length. In the back, however, we will be removing more because as you can see, it has more of that U shape that we really would like to see more of a firm foundation for her haircut. We're gonna put more beveled layers out in this area and firm up the foundation of her haircut. Then, on top of that, we are seeing all over the hair industry a fringe, a great strong fringe that's gonna go just below the eyebrow and really bring out those green hazel eyes of Miss Carly. However, we're not gonna extend it too far, just to about right here where the natural eyebrow or fringe area would be. And then we'll leave it slightly disconnected with the rest of the haircut. It'll have a really nice, edgy, more modern feel to her nice beachy waves. Let us get her shampooed and we'll get started. Now we have her shampooed. We've sectioned her off from the center of the head at the high point of the occipital bone down to the ear base. We work off diagonals, even though we are going to cut a nice firm foundation. We've agreed on 2 inches on her length to remove enough of this shatteredness. Because she had so many layers that were cut into her foundation, we need to firm it up a little bit more to give her more flexibility and more control over what her curl and shape are doing. Her curl, you can see, is easily, when it's wet, combed out. However, when it's cut, it springs up, just like most curly hair. And she was warning me not to cut too much because it will spring up, and that most stylists don't understand that. That's typical of curly hair. I think y'all would agree. So, we're gonna go in, as we did before, use the back of our blade. We're cutting the foundation, therefore our blade is down. We're gonna go from center to left, and we're going to use, like I said, the back of the blade. So we're gonna continue with the foundation, moving from center, left. We are using the back of the blade. When we move center, right, we will be using the front of the blade. The reason for that is so that we can use all of the razor. When you stand in front of the hair, sometimes if you're using too loose of a wrist, you're gonna get a wispier edge, as you saw. So what I do, because it's very difficult to go in and get those with your fingers out or fingers clasped, so we're going to have to go in and nip and pull. It's okay to do that. We're not really cutting foundation anymore, so we're getting more and more into the firmness of her actual previous haircut, which is exactly why we cut off 2 inches in the back. The very last segment of the haircut, especially in this front area, we need to make sure to maintain this corner so that it's the same length here as it is back here. When we do that, and to preserve that length, what we need to remember is that a face frame should never be any farther back into the foundation of the cut than in front of the ear. If you take it behind the ear, you're looking at taking out this whole corner, and then your length will be shorter up here than it is back here. Thus, it will make the U shape or the roundness that she had before, and it will compromise the actual foundation of the hair. To preserve that, what I've done is I comb everything down at 0 degrees, and then I bring it back this way. I will over-direct it, and then I will remove that length as it's needed. And now we can get started on her layers. All right, so what I'm doing now, instead of starting the layers in the back like traditionally we're taught to start the layers, I'm going to start them on the top. What that does, by starting the layers at the top, it's going to help to maintain the length through that foundation. What happened with Carly's hair before, we saw that it was very shattered on the ends, and a lot of that has to do with all the layers being cut between the crown and the occipital, as opposed to at the crown and above. When we cut the layers within the horseshoe subsection of the hair, what it helps to do is everything cascades over and it just softly whispers through, as opposed to it being too shattered and then possibly too short. Her previous layers, as you can see, somebody's gone in and they've done a lot of texturizing or thinning shear, or gone in with the shears and really whispered through it. And what that's done is it's left her with no control whatsoever on those ends. And with curly hair, you have to have control, because if you don't, it gets frizzy. So we're gonna go in, use a very soft wrist at a forward diagonal angle. The hair is up, therefore the blade is up, and it's pointed at me. I have more fluidity and flexibility with my wrist when it's like this, okay? We're going to remove this much length off of hers. We really want to give her some nice fluid layers. If you notice, my wrist is moving quite a bit. However, my hand is not moving. I am layering her hair, therefore my hand is stationary. In a minute, we will be doing graduation, therefore my hand will be moving. As I said, soft. It's not too blunt like what we'd done with the foundation. However, it has a firmness to it, and you can see the definite line. We can use three subsections within the horseshoe subsection. Her hair is getting dry. I'm starting to actually have to put the razor through the hair, as opposed to whisper the razor through the hair and let it do the job. So we're going to moisten it a little bit with our blade glide, which is a pharmaceutical grade silicone. We prepped her hair with it before, but now we need to go ahead and moisten it again. For those of y'all that like to have a guide, we can see the guide. Okay. Now we're gonna move to the other side. Once again, we need to moisten it a little bit because I think it's going to be too dry on those ends. You can see it's a nice fine mess. It will not impede your product line. Hair is up, blade is up. Softly whisper through the hair. It doesn't take any aggression on your part to cut with a nice sharp blade and on wet hair. When your hair is too dry or not wet enough, you're going to have to push on the hair, which in turn is going to give you the wrong angle on it, and it's going to rip it and break it and tear it, and then the hair is going to split, and or it's going to be uncomfortable for your client as she sits through the haircut. If you notice, I am palming my razor, especially when you're working with long hair. You want to make sure that you palm the razor back. What happens is, if you palm it like a pair of shears, you're going to be combing through. And when we comb through with a razor held like this, you can get extra texture and hair starts falling on the ground, and we've all done it. However, it's not a good idea. So let's palm our razors. We can start to see how her layers are softly whispered through the back, but they're not real blunt. This is not the haircut for the client that comes in and asks for three layers, one, two, and three. That's not gonna work at all here. We just wanted to softly whisper through and to be easy. All right, so we've cut that top area. We're starting to see more of that S formation in the way that the hair is falling. Now we're going to go in and blend the top horseshoe subsection into the rest of the length, being very careful to preserve the foundation of that cut that we put in earlier. The way that I like to do this is to work from the high point of the head, right up here. If you're not sure how to find the high point, put the comb on the top of the head, and wherever it teeter-totters off of is the high point of the head. We're going to comb it out. I like to use radial pie subsections, which means we're working off the high point of the head in a radius like a pie. We're just gonna go around this way on the top of the head. Comb that out of the way. We see the length that we cut a few minutes ago. Pull this straight out. We're gonna go from this shortness here down into our length. It's a good idea not to use any more of a subsection than the length of your hair. I'm sorry, of your fingers, not the hair, because it'd be a really long subsection. All right, we're gonna go in. If you notice now, the way that I'm holding the blade, it's down. However, I have to hold it more like this to really be able to go in and slice through the hair and cut the rest of its layers. So what I'm doing now is I'm going through and I'm using my wrist this way. If she were a little bit lower, we'd be going in and going this way. We're gonna comb this hair out of the way. It's cut. Go from the high point of the head. Once again, it's going from a very small pie subsection at the top of the head down to the bottom, which is probably a good inch to inch and a half wide in diameter. We see our shortness here. We're gonna go in and cut this way. If you notice, my fingers are moving as I cut, and that is intentional because I want to go from shortest to longest. This is graduation. When you graduate, your fingers move. When you layer, your fingers do not move. I'm not pulling a guide. My guide at this point is the length at the crown that we cut, and then also our foundation. Those are my two guide points, because we're blending and marrying those two together. I see my short point again, going in, using a nice soft wrist. Even though her hair is curly, you can still have a little bit softer edge. However, it has a firmness to it. If you'll notice, I'm only taking the subsection to right at the middle of her ear, because remember, this is pretty much her face frame area, and this is also her fringe that we're getting ready to detail and design for her. Now, let's look at the difference between the two sides as far as how her layers and her curl is lying. This one is nice and fluid. It moves well. This one is still a little bit heavy. See how the whole section kind of moves? Whereas this one, you move here and everything moves, but it goes in a nice S formation. Just continuing in radius pie subsections around the head. We have two more subsections, and then we're gonna have some fun with a little bit of weight release for specifically for curly hair. It can be done in straight hair, but it's a lot more successful in curly. Let's check the length. I think it's still a little long right here. A little bit square. All right. Her hair is much thicker and more dense on this side than it is on this side. So we're gonna remove weight specifically for each side. but we can see how her curl is already behaving totally different than what it did before. I'm really liking what I see. All right, now it's not really necessary to have it completely damp. However, I want to see where the thick areas and the finer areas of the hair are. Kind of shake your hands through it. Get the curl to kind of trundle together as opposed to being separated. When you're combing the hair with the fine edge of the comb, and that's what you have to do when you're cutting with the razor, then it separates too much. And instead of it falling like this, it falls like this, which makes it bigger, and you don't get the trundle that you're asking for out of the actual hair shape. So we're gonna go back, comb it with the large edge of the comb. In larger subsections, working off the diagonals of the head as we have been. We're gonna go in, comb out. Still use the fine areas of the comb. Go in with your shears and notch through it. What that does is it removes weight. However, it removes weight in a controlled subsection as opposed to it being in a V, which takes it from shortest to longest. If you were to do any of the weight release techniques that you see me do on straight hair, on curly hair, it's gonna be the same as that 1980s big band hair. It's gonna make it expand because those short pieces are kicking against longer pieces and it makes it grow. This way, by trundling it together, you can already see the difference in how that area falls as opposed to how some of the other areas did in the past. We're gonna take and just barely close our shear, barely close the shear, and we're gonna chip cut is what I call it, or bounce cutting, because we're taking out a chip about a quarter of an inch in each space. However, when you comb through it, you really can't see what you've removed and what you haven't removed. That's the best part. Chip cut all the way up. Thick areas. Never going any higher up than the midsection of the hair. That's a nice little rule of thumb. The hair naturally bends at the midsection of the hair, and you don't have to worry about any of those short pieces that stick up and say, hey, I'm not gonna do what you asked me to. It's a nice little forget you spot. We don't want those. We want control. See the difference in the way that her hair is trundling, even after we've gone through it with a fine tooth comb, literally. Through here. There's a heavy area here. However, I want a little more control right here. Go to the other side. Finish what we were doing. Heavy area. Heavy area. Remember I said her left-hand side of her head is a much more dense space. Only where the hair is the thickest do we remove weight. If you remove it where it's not needed, it will collapse your style. What we're gonna do in just a moment, after we get finished removing weight, we're gonna go rinse all this loose hair out, apply some curl cream. Nicaroja has been sweet enough to let us use some of his products. It's in a wonderful packaging and fragrance, and the product is amazing, and I've really enjoyed using it because it has a really nice hand to it. It's not a real thick product line, and it goes through the hair nicely. I think what she'll be the most excited about is that we have stuck with our original plan, which was to only take off about an inch and a half in the front of her hair area that she sees. We firmed up the foundation of her hair, and now her hair is more controlled and a lot less flyaway than what it was. So we're gonna get her dampened, let it dry naturally with a little bit of curl cream on it, and then we'll bring her back to do the fringe. Thanks so much. Remember, we were talking about a nice, great bang or fringe that will gently kiss right underneath the eyebrow and really bring out her hazel eyes. The way that we're going to do that is first we need to distinguish where her bang is going to start and where the bang is going to stop. Bangs traditionally, wherever the comb leaves the head, let me turn so you can see, wherever the comb leaves the head is where a bang or a fringe should start. If you don't start it in the right position, if you start it too close or too far back, if you start it too far back, it's gonna go into your hairline. If you start it too far forward, this area that wants to grow forward is still gonna kick over that bang, and your bangs are gonna be kind of out of control and a little bit less structured. So we wanna start where the comb leaves the head. We're gonna round it out to the high point of the eyebrow. If you take it any further back, once again, you're getting into the hairline. Hers actually can go a smidge further for the high point of her eyebrow. I like to work off of an oval section as opposed to a triangular section, because the triangular sections, what happens is, turn your head towards me and actually look down a little bit, please. There we go. Triangular sections don't give as good of a finish on the fringe. If you noticed, while we were cutting her hair, I allowed for her area that was going to be the fringe to be more forward and in her eyes. Generally, as stylists, we don't want our clients' hair in their eyes. However, this allows for me to see where her hair is naturally gonna fall and where it's not gonna fall. So if she has any calyx that are gonna be a surprise for us, they would have already shown up. I don't see anything that's going to impede her having a fringe in any way, shape, or form. So I think she's definitely a great candidate for a fringe. We're gonna work this in three different subsections. We're gonna zigzag out her fringe. What this will do is it will allow for it to have idiosyncrasies in it and be soft. We see how her hair naturally moves and shapes. So we're going to pull it forward, chin up for me, please. Pull it forward. And for my sake, I'm gonna cut it at her nose, straight across. That way it's the beginning of the fringe. Now, turn slightly this way. So for the sake of me seeing what I'm doing, I'm gonna go in, I'm gonna cut, point cut one way with my Kaiden shears, because they have amazing tips and it's our new technology. The blades are a lot like our plier straight razors. They cut very true, a great Japanese shear. The most important thing is they are literally switchblade shears. You can change the blade out whenever you're ready to have them sharpened. All right, so we're starting to see how her fringe shapes up. We'll leave this alone on that end. We're gonna allow for some more of this lace to come down. Using the tip of my comb, pull that back. I'm not pulling it down really hard. I'm allowing for her natural face or hairline to pull up. It's also allowing it to shrink the way it wants to, as opposed to how I want it to. Point cut one way, point cut the opposite. Move it. Shape it, see what it's doing. It's looking really great. What a great new look for you. Wonderful for the summer. and make sure I have everything that I need to have. Look down for me. All right, we see our nice oval chin up. We're not cutting into her hairline. Once again, pull it forward. We may cut more after I get it finished blown dry. This is a great start to a wonderful new look from Miss Carly. And now, she looks chic. We let Carly dry naturally and we're seeing how the cut has fallen, and now we can see that we have more firmness on the edges. The curl is trundling better. We are going to remove a little bit of length right here. I like the disconnection between her face, her previous face frame and her new fringe, but we need to soften this out a little bit more using the Kaidens. I'm going to follow the way her natural wave does. This is hair that is only in front of the ear. I like to carve every individual piece in with the natural wave. It makes it behave better and grow out nicer as time goes on. Now over here, exact same thing. I'm seeing a little bit of length here. I want to remove that. I'm going to soften this through here, firm up those ends. Same with this area right here, firm that up. Cut a little bit into that curl. Okay, so now what we're gonna do, we've done our face frame, love what it's doing. Now we're gonna go in, we're gonna blow dry the fringe and then also smooth out this top area a little bit more. Carly, I think it's about time to show your new do to you.
I'm so excited.
Let's see the mirror. Ta-da.
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. I love it. It's so cute. It's
we keep so it different. Smooth through the top, and then it's really going to open up and accentuate those eyes. And of course, you already have an amazing smile, but this just helps to really give it a little bit more edge and very editorial.
Oh, it's so, it's great. I love it.
Yay. All right, we'll get ready for the photo shoot now. I'm Christie Waldrop with Jatai International, and we look forward to seeing you soon.